Alrighty. So today I'll be talking about NMR applied to polymer-derived ceramics. So on the agenda today, I'll be talking about traditional ceramics, what they are, their properties, and how they are synthesized. I'll be talking about polymer-derived ceramics and how they are different from traditional ceramics. I'll be talking about the synthesis of polymer-derived ceramics. I'll be talking about my own research and then how NMR fits into the equation. So traditional ceramics are ionically bonded solids. They are usually crystalline, which means that they exhibit long-range order as far as structure. And then they are usually a non-metal such as oxygen, nitrogen, or carbon bonded to a metal or a semiconductor. For our purposes, we are especially interested in our carbon, nitrogen, oxygen bonded with aluminum, silicon, germanium, or tin. And those are for our purposes, but obviously there's way more than that. And then as far as properties, traditional ceramics do show very high thermal stability up to 2000 degrees Celsius. And this is a very mundane example, but this is why we make our coffee mugs out of ceramics, because when we put our coffee mugs in the microwave to heat up our coffee, we don't want that coffee mug to get like way too hot, so then we can't touch it. So ceramic coffee mugs exhibit that thermal stability. Traditional ceramics also have a very high modulus of elasticity, which means that they are very, very stiff and brittle. So over here, I have a table of some common ceramics. And as you can see, their modulus of elasticity is very high between about 120 and about 400 gigapascals. And then I also have, compared to metals, I have this table of metals, and compared to metals, they have a very high modulus. Metals modulus between these, aluminum, brass, and copper, between about 70 gigapascals and 110. And obviously there are exceptions to this. Tungsten is a very good example of an exception because it has a modulus of about 407 gigapascals, which is higher than any ceramic on this list. These properties are well illustrated in this graph right here, plotting density versus modulus of elasticity. And if we're looking at ceramics, we're looking at this kind of yellow bubble up here, and this is a logarithmic scale. So these ceramics have a very high modulus compared to metals and any other material here. And there is some overlap, and obviously there are some exceptions, but generally ceramics are very stiff, very brittle. So then a very nice high-tech example of traditional ceramics being used is fibrous refractory composite insulation. And simply put, these are just the tiles that we use on the outside of spacecraft. When spacecraft are re-entering our atmosphere after doing things in space, they encounter very high temperatures as they attempt to re-enter our atmosphere. And so we can't have our space shuttles just completely falling apart or disintegrating when they try to come back to Earth. So we use these fibrous refractory composite insulation tiles to make sure that that doesn't happen. These are ceramics, so they can withstand those high temperatures. And so when we talk about traditional ceramics have been around for thousands of years. This is an ancient Japanese pot that was used for storing and processing fish, and it dates between about 13,000 and 6,000 years BC. And the research on this pot showed that they used it for storing fish because during this time, the Earth was in a glacial period, and they had to have containers that could withstand like sharp changes in the thermal environment. So they used this ceramic pot to store their fish so that everything stayed fresh and edible. So now let's talk about these new kinds of ceramics. So they're new because they were only developed in the last 50 years, which compared to thousands of years, they're brand new. So these new kinds of ceramics are polymer-derived ceramics, abbreviated PDCs. And these differ from traditional ceramics in that they are covalently bonded and they are amorphous, so they don't show any long-range order. And so to get a polymer-derived ceramic, as the name entails, we actually start with polymer. We start with a polymeric ceramic precursor. And over here on the right, I have a a figure of many examples of these polymeric ceramic precursors. And compared to the number of possible compositions we can have for a traditional ceramic, the number of compositions we can have for a polymer-derived ceramic are relatively small because we are limited by the elements that we can use. Generally, silicon is involved in these polymeric ceramic precursors, and so that definitely limits how many compositions we can actually have. And because we start with a polymer, before we heat treat, we start with a polymer, there are machinability differences. So back to this table here, we start down in this red bubble for our polymers before we heat treat. And so this is a logarithmic scale. So these polymers have a modulus of elasticity on the order of about 1,000 times smaller than the ceramics up here. So, and then polymers are more ductile, they have a low melting temperature, and they're lighter. So there are a lot of, there are a lot more possibilities for how we can machine polymer-derived ceramics and polymeric ceramic precursors because they start out as polymers. And then eventually, I mean, we will move up into this yellow region of ceramics, but we start down here. So we have a lot of possibilities for machining. So now we'll go into a brief history of polymer-derived ceramics. As the story goes, polymer-derived ceramics were an accident. A student was just trying to cure a polymer overnight, and he was really tired. And so he accidentally put one zero too many on the oven to cure the polymer. And so he cured it at 1,000 degrees Celsius instead of 100. And so he got back the next morning, and he actually found a ceramic material. And so over the last 50 years, there have been many contributions. Some of the really important ones, this man, Gerhard Fritz here, he came up with he was the first person to report on polymeric ceramic precursors. And then the next really, really important advance in this polymer-derived ceramics is the work of Yajima. And he came up with the cross-linking process for silicon carbide fibers. And he started with a polymer, polycarbomethyl silane. And obviously prior to cross-linking and pyrolyzing, you'll have to shape it. But once that's done, he came up with cross-linking and pyrolyzing at very high temperatures, and he got silicon carbide fibers. And so we're still using this process today. And so this development is very important to us, and we're still improving and using it today. So now let's look at the differences between how traditional ceramics and polymer-derived ceramics are synthesized. So with traditional ceramics, we start with some ceramic powder, we mix it into a slurry, and then we mold and shape it, and then we sinter it. Here I have a graphic of what sintering, how sintering kind of works. And so we start with these larger grains, and we start with these pores. And so this is before sintering. And then during sintering, these grains are going to sort of meld together and kind of close that pore. And then after sintering, we'll have like one large grain with a small pore. And this happens at very high temperatures, and it takes a long time. And so one thing I like to think about when I think about traditional ceramics is if maybe in school or even as an adult, if you ever took a pottery class, you start out with, they give you some clay, which is kind of like your slurry, and you're able to mold and shape it with your hands. And then when you put it into the kiln, that's like sintering it. And then you get your product, you get your hard like mug or pot or something. And so that whole process is analogous to how we process traditional ceramics. And so here's another picture of our fibrous refractory composite insulation tiles. And these are traditional ceramics. They were produced via sintering. So then now let's look at polymer-derived ceramics. So with polymer-derived ceramics, we start with a pre-ceramic polymer, and this is usually liquid oligomer. And usually we'll add this pre-ceramic polymer to some base material, some polymer, and then we can machine, shape, and form that. And like I said, there are lots of possibilities for machining and shaping these polymers before cross-linking and pyrolyzing. And we'll cross-link and pyrolyze at between 100 and 400 degrees Celsius, and then we'll pyrolyze between 400 and 1400 degrees Celsius. And down here, I have a simple graphic of the cross-linking and pyrolyzing for a siloxane. So over here, we start with our liquid oligomer, and then we can cross-link it, and we'll break some of the bonds, we'll get rid of some of the hydrogen, and we'll get this more amorphous structure. It's still organic, we still have hydrogen, but then we will pyrolyze it, and all the hydrogen will burn off, and then we will get this final product, this amorphous inorganic ceramic. So now let's look at that in more detail. So Again, we start with our liquid oligomer, and two things to note. We also have the presence of a cross-linking agent, and this reaction is not pictured. The cross-linking agent is a catalyst, and so the reactions that it causes are short-lived, and then after which the cross-linking agent is consumed, but this is not pictured. Keep in mind that this is happening. And then the other thing is we have these vinyl groups here, which I've highlighted in yellow, and these vinyl groups are which break during our first step, our cross-linking process. And so when we cross-link, we will break those vinyl groups, we'll break those bonds, and so then the vinyl groups will be burned off, the hydrogen in them will be burned off, and we'll get this this more amorphous structure. The rings will kind of be bonded together from the breaking of these bonds, and we'll still have an organic material here. And then after pyrolyzing, it is the hydrogen in the methyl groups that's going to leave, and we will get our final amorphous inorganic ceramic here. So how do we know this is happening? Obviously, we can't, like, there's no microscope that we can, like, look down and actually see all of these chemical formulas and lines and all. We can't do that. That's not a thing that happens. But we know this is all happening because of nuclear magnetic resonance. So nuclear magnetic resonance, as I've talked about in my prior presentations, are very effective for polymers. Polymers have many elements that have NMR active nuclei, such as hydrogen, carbon, silicon, and so we can use NMR to figure out how that polymer changes into a ceramic. So we may do NMR with our pre-ceramic polymer and see what we're working with, what's going on, and then we will do our cross-linking and pyrolyzing process, and then we can look at, after we can do NMR, we can look at how those bonds changed, what happened, like what bonds were broken, and what new ones formed. And so on the right here, I have a silicon 29 NMR for an amorphous polymer-derived silicon oxycarbide ceramic. As you can see, there are multiple peaks corresponding to silicon in different bonding situations with oxygen and carbon. And usually, when we do NMR, we wouldn't want to do, you know, one silicon 29 NMR and just go, oh, we're done. We know what the molecules look like. We know everything. We would want to do another NMR to just confirm what we've inferred about the molecular structure. So then we also have a carbon 13 NMR for this material. And so two peaks came up with, this was the bond between two carbon, and that was evident, for example, in our siloxane in the last slide. You can see lots of bonds between carbon and carbon. And then we also have the NMR for, the peak for carbon bonded to four silicon. And obviously this is not the same material as the example siloxane in the last slide, but we can make comparisons between this material and the other material. They have similar elements present, and they're both PDCs. So then now let's talk about my research. So I'm doing research with polysiloxane fibers. So the first thing I'll start with is a polyacrylic acid, and you can see the structure here. It's a polymer. We abbreviate it PAA. And then we'll add a polymeric ceramic precursor. We will add polysiloxane, and here's its structure right here. And then we will also add our cross-linking agent. In our case, it's dichemyl peroxide, or DCP, and here's its structure. And generally what we will do is we will make a solution of polysiloxane and dichemyl peroxide, polysiloxane being our solvent. And so generally we will do either 1 weight percent dichemyl peroxide, as you can see in this bottle right here. This bottle has polysiloxane with 1 weight percent dichemyl peroxide. I mean, we might also do 10 weight percent dichemyl peroxide. And so we will also, after we've made this solution, we will also add water, not to this solution, we will add water to the experiment to aid in getting the right viscosity so I can actually draw the polysiloxane fibers. So what actually happens is, so when I start, I'll make a slurry or a dough with the correct viscosity. I'll put polyacrylic acid into a cup, and then I'll put my polysiloxane and dichemyl peroxide solution. I'll mix it together, and then I'll add water drop by drop to make sure that it's at the correct viscosity. And then once it's at the correct viscosity, I'll put it onto a popsicle stick, and I will use a pair of tweezers to gather fibers and then stretch them across this aluminum foil boat. As you can see in this animation, if you look closely, you'll be able to see the fibers that I'm drawing here. And we use aluminum foil for this boat because this aluminum foil boat will not deform during our cross-linking process. So our fibers will stay tight and they won't be damaged during our cross-linking process. And so when we cross-link for these fibers, for these polysiloxane fibers, we cross-link at 160 degrees Celsius. And once that's done, we will have our cross-link fibers. And so we haven't done this yet, but the next step will be to pyrolyze these cross-link fibers to get our final product. So in summary, I talked about traditional ceramics and their properties and then I talked about polymer-derived ceramics, how they're different from traditional ceramics in how they're synthesized. Talked about the specifics of synthesizing PDCs. And then I talked about the application for nuclear magnetic resonance, and I talked about my own research. So then my presentation schedule, I've given 3 presentations this summer, the first one being over spectroscopy atoms and spin. And then the second presentation was actually 2 presentations melded together. I talked about nuclear shielding, chemical equivalence, electronegativity, and chemical shift. And then finally today I talked about NMR applied to polymer-derived ceramics. So thank you. Any questions?